Well, good morning, Fort family. Happy Sunday. We're so glad you've joined us today. My name is Erwin. I'm one of the pastors here on staff. And for those that are new, joining us for the first time online, welcome here. We'd love to get connected with you. And so I know that it's not as easy as just saying hi through a screen, but if you'd like to come and visit us in person, we'll be at the church generally Monday to Friday throughout the week. You can give us a call at 604-888-7131. You can send us a message or an email, office@flefc.org, and we would love to connect with you. There are a few things going on that we need you to know about, and the main one is that on July 18th, which is coming Sunday, we are going to be opening up our sanctuary for anyone that wants to come and engage in the service together at 10 a.m. This is going to be a great opportunity, again, to meet together as the church body, to fellowship, to be the church in each other's presence. So if you would like to join us, a couple things that you need to know for that. First is that masks are not required for you to be here. It's a personal preference. Second is that if there are going to be people here that want to be here but aren't quite comfortable being super close to people, so we just ask that you respect people's boundaries and their personal space. Also, we are able to sing together and engage in a sermon together. We're going to be taking communion together, so feel free to bring your own elements. And there's going to be a kids ministry happening as well. They're going to be dismissed after the sung worship and engaging in the gym in their own lesson and their time together. That is for ages 5 to 11. So ages 5 to 11 in the gym, a little program there. For kids ages 0 to 4 are welcome to join as well, but we just need a parent to come with them into the gym for that time. Also, that's for something that's going to be continuing on, moving forward, is a pre-service Cafe Connect. So we're going to be opening up the gym at 9:30 for anyone that wants to come and hang out. A bring your own coffee kind of Cafe Connect, just with some of the things that we're still figuring out. It'd be great if for everyone to bring their own coffee, come before the service, and fellowship together in the gym. So that is July 18th. We're going to be able to be here together in the service. We set the whole sanctuary up for us to be able to do that. There are lots of things happening in the life of our church, and the best way for you to find out what that is to actually just check the bulletin that we send out on Thursdays. There's lots of information in there. Scroll through it, find the one that applies to you, and especially between our kids, our youth, and our young adults programs, there's a lot of things happening. So check that out. Come and engage with us. We'd love to meet you and see you in your wonderful faces again soon. Now, one other thing that we want to share with you is that we are starting to prepare both the kids and the youth ministry for a big fall and throughout the 2021-2022 season, which is crazy to think about. But one of the things that we need to do as we set that up is we need to fill out some volunteer roles. And so if you have any interest in serving with both the kids or either the kids and the youth ministries, please reach out to us. You can reach out to us just at office@flefc.org, and we would love to connect with you and engage with you in what that looks like and the different ways that you would be able to serve. So again, lots of things happening. Check the bulletin for more information. Today we have the privilege of hearing from Neil Bassingthwaite. He's going to come up and speak to us later about our third statement of faith. So as we engage with the service, as we engage with the message, we just ask God to come in and bless our time together this morning.
Good morning, church family. My name is Britt. I'm one of the leaders here at Fort Langley Evangelical Free Church, and I'm joined by Brent, Connie, Martin, and Kyle, and we're so happy to have you with us. We'll be even happier when we're all in person again, so please consider joining us when the time comes that you are comfortable with coming. Let's begin this morning by giving praise where praise is due, by giving glory where glory is due, by ascribing worth to the one who is worthy, and by praising the one who has met our deepest need with his generous, generous grace. And I'm talking about Jesus. Let's stand wherever you are and worship him this morning. Our service today will be a continuation in our series on the statements of faith that we believe in our church. And today we're going to be talking about how God's gospel alone addresses our deepest need. And in our statement we say this, that we believe that God created Adam and Eve in his image, but they sinned when tempted by Satan. And in union with Adam, human beings are sinners by nature and by choice, alienated from God and under his wrath. And it is only through God's saving work in Jesus Christ that we can be rescued, reconciled, and renewed. And so I want us, especially in this moment of sung worship, to reflect on those three words, especially that we can be rescued, that we can be reconciled and renewed. And so I just invite you, as we sing through these next couple of songs, to pay attention to words or lyrics that stick out to you about how God makes his grace available to us, about how our relationship with him is reconciled through Christ Jesus, and to let that truth impact your heart and your heart of worship this morning.
I was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I'd hear you call. But Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own, I had no right to draw near your throne. But Father, you loved me still. And in love before you laid the world's foundation, predestined to adopt me as your own. And you have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. I swore I knew the way on my own, head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. The Spirit, you moved in me. And at your touch, my sleeping spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Called into I will run.
Hi, church family. My name is Phyllis Donnelly, and I've been attending the church here for about 10 years now. I'm so thankful for the leadership at the church. About 2 years ago, a few years ago, they encouraged us to get together and to really seek the Lord to pray for the direction for our church. We had no idea the years that followed, but I'm so thankful that we have a church who seek God and desire His direction for us. I'm thankful for our present leadership, for Jason and Irwin. And we started off January with looking at the Christian disciplines. And in January, we were encouraged to read the Bible through in 2 years. I really like that 2-year program. And so we were encouraged to read the Bible and then connect with another person in the church. And Miriam reached out to me, and so we've made that connection. And after reading a portion, we'll share our thoughts and questions. And it's been good for me because although I've journaled before, this gives me a chance to reflect and to be able to write something down so that somebody else will understand what I'm saying. And then Miriam shares her thoughts and questions with me. It's been very beneficial. And I would like to say that we've been spot on every day, but we haven't. And so every now and then we do a catch up. And we also get together periodically and just discuss what God's been teaching us and any questions. A lot of times questions arise over what we've read. And it's been a very beneficial. So I've heard that when people are being trained to detect counterfeit bills, that first of all, they look at the genuine bill and they spend a lot of time studying all the characteristics of the genuine bill so that they can easily spot when something is amiss. And then I've heard that applied to reading our Bible as well, that we really need to know God's word so that when somebody speaks a falsehood or maybe a partial truth, we can detect that and perhaps help to clarify that. So I thank the leadership for encouraging us to read our Bible, to know what it says. And as Erin was saying on Sunday, we can believe the Bible, we can obey the Bible, we can trust the Bible.
Well, good morning. It's good to be with you on video here. I think I will also wind up being with you on Sunday morning, so looking forward to that. Bring you greetings from the Evangelical Free Church of Canada home office, just down the road here on Trinity Western Campus, although most of us that work there actually don't work in the office right at the moment, but we will be returning soon, and it's going to be a whole new office. If you haven't been on campus to see that, you should get there and check it out. We actually have two people coming from home office, kind of back to back. I'm with you this week. Our executive director, Bill Taylor, will be with you next week, so I hope you're looking forward to that. Unfortunately, this week you got to put up with me. So there you have it. We're in this series entitled Gospel Hearts, Gospel Minds, preaching through the statement of faith, the different articles that make up the statement of faith, your statement of faith, the Evangelical Free Church statement of faith, and really getting down to this sense of what we believe and why it matters and how it actually connects with our hearts. My particular article is Article 3. You've had the first two articles already, and Article 3 really is about the human condition, the human story. It's our story. The gospel header that begins the article says this: God's gospel alone addresses our deepest human need. And the article goes on to say this: we believe that God created Adam and Eve in his image, but they sinned when tempted by Satan. In union with Adam, human beings are sinners by nature and by choice, alienated from God and under his wrath. Only through God's saving work in Jesus Christ can we be rescued, reconciled, and renewed. There's a lot to flesh out in that statement. And as we think about that, maybe a good illustration of that might be the brand new movie. It's not released yet. It's going to be coming out later this month. The new movie by M. Night Shyamalan. Now, for any of you who kind of like those psychological thrillers, almost into that kind of a horror movie genre, that name will tweak right away for you. I've kind of always have a bit of a like for those kinds of things, because I think fear is one of our primary emotions as human beings. And here's a storyteller that has somehow captured a way into that and to work with that and to demonstrate the kinds of things we're afraid of. And this particular movie, entitled Old, is no different. The people depicted in the movie are on vacation, and part of their vacation, they go and they find this kind of pristine, hidden away, little treasure of a beach. And it's beautiful. And they're enjoying the beach until there's this plot twist where they begin to realize that their lives are quickly moving along. And on this particular beach, life moves very fast. And in fact, their entire lives are going to be lost in one day. And they begin to panic and try and find a way off the beach. And there is no way off the beach. They are trapped in this aging and dying. And the panic ensues. In many ways, that's this article. It starts out wonderful. And then suddenly we realize something tragic has gone on that's made everything wrong. And there needs to be a remedy, a way out. So it's those three pieces that I want to kind of take this article and divide it into. And I want us to start with what humans were made for, what we were designed to be. Image bearers, God's image bearers. And as we delve into Scripture this morning, I want us to start with a song, because I think songs can help make our theology something that hits our hearts. Now, this particular song is found in the book of Psalms. It really, in many ways, is inspired by Genesis 1. It's Psalm 8. And it's beautifully structured in a very traditional Hebrew kind of form, a chiasm, so that the outer points, the first and the last things, correspond to each other. And as you move deeper into the psalm, you get to the middle of the psalm. And the middle of the psalm is actually the primary point of the psalm. And so Psalm 8 begins like this: O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. And verse 9, the last verse of the psalm, echoes that same sentiment, saying, O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. If we move deeper into the psalm, we realize why God's majestic name fills the earth. It's because of what God did, how he created. If you look at verse 3, when I look at the night sky and I see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you set in place, what are mere mortals? Now, we're going to leave that verse 4 in just a second, but you get the train of thought there. God's creation is magnificent. The corresponding point is what we pick up in verse 6. Humans are supposed to do something with the creation of God. You gave them, God gave us, charge of everything that he made, putting all things under our authority, the flocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds and the sky and the fish and the sea and everything that swims, the ocean currents. God made, we're supposed to caretake. And the pinnacle of this psalm is found in verse 4 and 5, where it talks about humans and how God made them. It says, what are mere mortals? And that's probably what we're thinking at this point in time as we look at God's great creation, and we're thinking, I'm pretty insignificant. And that's kind of the sentiment of the song. What are mere mortals that you should think about them, human beings that you should care for them? And the answer comes in verse 5. Yet you made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. We were made for something significant. If we go back to Genesis 1, 26 and through 28, we read words that sound very similar to what we just read in Psalm 8. And I think they are the inspiration for that song. Then God said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. So God created human beings in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. He blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and govern it. Significant role. Now, to help us kind of get our heads around what it means to be an image bearer, and we could probably spend, well, we could spend your whole preaching series doing that, probably, but we just don't have time to do that. So suffice it to say, if we can think a little bit about a pagan temple and an image that might be contained in it. Now, I have a picture that I took, which is not an Middle Eastern ancient pagan temple. It actually happens to be one that I snapped in the Mayan jungle at Chichen Itza. But it looks very similar to a Middle Eastern ancient temple. You'll notice that there are stairways that go up and down. Initially, pagan people thought that was the entrance for the god to come down to earth. Which is interesting when you get to Genesis chapter 11 and you read about the people that want to build a tower that's going to reach to heaven. Human arrogance exerts itself and turns the doorway the other way. Up till that time, people thought it was about the God coming to them. Now, at the very pinnacle of the temple, where supposedly the God might reside, They knew that God actually didn't reside there permanently, but they wanted to be reminded of that, so they put an image, an idol, that would represent the God, and they put it there. Now, you should ask, why does that matter? Why does any of this matter, really? God designed us to be his image bearers, to somehow represent him, to look like him. Got another great picture here of Jim Carrey with the little Jim Carrey. Looks a lot like him. Helps when you Photoshop the head onto the, you know, the other little body there, right? But in many ways, that's exactly how we are to image God. We were created to be lookalikes of God. But not just to look like him, to in some ways act like him. He created, we caretake his creation. We become stewards of what he made. Now, that's a word that we don't use very often anymore. Stewards. It's probably a word that we should use more often. We in our day and age kind of think that we own stuff. We forget that they're actually gifts from God that have been entrusted to us to use to benefit everyone. That's what stewarding God's good creation entails. That's just a little bit of what goes into being made in the image of God. It's a phenomenal responsibility and something really, really important and significant. If that doesn't impact you in some way, that you were designed for that, I'm not sure what else would. But something went wrong. Just like those people suddenly realizing that they're on the beach and they're dying, something dramatically bad happened. Just have to flip over a few pages in the account of Genesis to get to Genesis 3, where sin enters the world. Now, before we get to that, I want to highlight a verse from Romans, because Romans seems to indicate this sin that entered the world is a universal condition. Romans 5:12 talks about Adam as the founder of the human race, and that every one of us is included in Adam's sin because we are all sinners. That's pretty devastating, especially when we were designed for something great. But let's look at just how ugly this sin really is. Genesis chapter 3, you know the background. God created this garden. He placed Adam and Eve in the garden. He said, all of the trees are for you to eat from except for that one tree. And along comes the serpent to tempt human beings. And his very first attempt to tempt them is to get them to doubt God. To doubt God's goodness and God's trustworthiness. That he knows what he's actually telling them is good. He says, you won't die, to Eve. God knows that your eyes will be opened. This is verse 5. As soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. God's lying to you is essentially the assumption in that statement. God's withholding something from you that would be for your good. In verse 6, the woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. And so she acts independently of God to decide right and wrong for herself. And interestingly, Adam is right there. Notice. It says, so she took some of the fruit and ate it, and she gave some to her husband who was with her. They're in this together. And he ate it too. And notice the effects start instantaneously. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness, so they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. Now I'm going to pop a screen up here that shows some of the effects of sin, and we're going to walk through this as we look at this particular passage of Scripture. But the very first one you will notice is that they felt shame. Something internally broke within these human beings the moment they sinned. This was not simply an opening of their eyes and being able to now know good and evil. This broke them. And we've been broke ever since, wondering if we can measure up, wondering if we're good enough, feeling ashamed of ourselves. This is part of the human condition. They go on. It says in verse 8, when the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking in the garden. So they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Their relationship with God is now somehow severed. Something that was beautiful communion between these created beings and the Creator is now broken. It goes on and says, God called to them, and they replied, we heard you walking in the garden, so we hid. We were afraid because we were naked. Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree? And the man replied, it was, notice, now the blame game starts. And he blames two people. It was the woman you gave me who gave me the fruit, and I ate it. Two people are to blame. The woman you gave me, and you gave her to me, so you're ultimately to blame too. Human relationships begin to break down. God, in announcing some of the effects of sin later in this passage, talks about the fact that man will rule over woman. That was not the original design. Let me be very clear about that. Power dynamics were not the original design for human relationships. God designed human relationships in this mutual respect and connection that was for each other's good. They were equals and partners, each supporting one another. And now they're playing power games. And if you think about it, every human relationship, no matter how good that human relationship most of the time is, has moments where you play power games, where you manipulate just a little bit, where you try and get what you want instead of what the other person wants. Because that's human nature. We're selfish. We're sinful. And it all started here. But there's one more relationship that I want to talk about that also broke that day. God goes on talking about the different kinds of effects that sin is going to have, and he mentions the fact that the ground is cursed down in verse 17. The ground is cursed, and you're going to have to scratch out a living, struggling, because it's going to grow thorns and thistles. Even our relationship with nature is broken, and nature itself is marred. When we think of sin, I'm not convinced we've got a big enough, ugly enough picture of just how evil it is. Every single thing that God designed good has been twisted by sin. We need a remedy. A very significant remedy. And I'm not going to say a whole lot here except to say that that's that last chunk of the statement. We've worked through the first couple of chunks of the statement about being created in God's image and about sinning when tempted by Satan in union with Adam, and that we were sinners by nature and by choice, alienated from God. But this final chunk says that only through God's saving work in Jesus Christ can we be rescued, reconciled, and renewed. Three incredibly important words. And I don't know a passage of Scripture, and there's probably one, I'm sure, but this is one of my favorites. I'm not sure there's a better passage of Scripture to talk about that than the second chapter of Ephesians. And we don't have time to delve into all of that today, but Paul lays out in the first part of that chapter how we are dead in sin, completely separated from God. We all, and he makes those points over and over again, that all of us used to live that way. And then comes verse 4 is one of these dramatic hinge verses that suddenly all this dark, black ugliness disappears in the light of God's incredible love and mercy. Listen to the verse. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. And as we keep moving down through that passage, we get to some of those very famous, well-known verses about the fact that this is a free gift of God. Salvation comes to us simply because of Jesus. It's not something that we can do. It's not something we can boast in. And then we get to verse 10. For we are God's masterpiece. Listen, because these words, this verse, in some ways captures these three words of rescued, reconciled, and renewed in a way that I think is almost poetic. For we are God's masterpiece, his artwork, his story. He has created us anew. Not the old creation that was marred. Created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. All that image-bearing stuff that kind of got messed up along the way because of sin, we're being recommissioned to it as new creations in Jesus Christ. Why does it matter? Why does any of this really matter? Theology oftentimes can be dry and dusty stuff, right? It's in that textbook, you pull it off the wall. Oh yeah, that's what I believe. Pop back up onto the shelf again. But does it really hit our hearts? If we don't find ourselves in this story, if this does not impact us, what else will? We begin to recognize our great calling and how that was marred. And then along comes Jesus. Now, here's the problem. Many of us as Christians, I think that Jesus is kind of like the duct tape WD-40 combo pack. He's supposed to be there to fix everything, right? And there's certainly some things that Jesus does for us, and he does fix things. But if that's the only reason we have Jesus, that's pretty pathetic. Because we read words like rich in mercy and God loved us so much. In fact, one of the most common verses in our Bibles talks for God so loved the world. That ought to hit our hearts. That ought to make us come to Jesus and just bask in the goodness, the greatness, the love, the mercy, the treasure that Jesus is. I don't know that we do that enough. Just fall in love with Jesus again. Simply because his news is so good and we would be so lost without him. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Gratitude really ought to be something that just exudes from us after hearing this human story. We had no way off the beach. None. You made the way. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, but through the fiercest driving storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when strife. body of